very warm welcome to all of you present here for the 2 days national conference. As per the tradition of our university, let us begin with 2 minutes of concentration with Guru Vandana. My health, my hope, and my courage. With these lines from the mother, I welcome you all to this national conference on challenges and changing roles of placement officers post-COVID-19 across business school on behalf of Oro University School of Business. We are here to have a serious deliberation on the theme, as this pandemic has changed the way we used to see the world. The markets, the demand, the expectations have taken an absolute 360 degree turn, and we need to rethink about our strategies and the way to reach the markets. We need to be more self-dependent, and this has also changed the way our academic institutions have to deliver the KAS to the students. During our 2-day online conference, we will deliberate on the challenge and opportunities we have in front of us as universities, academicians, teachers, industry, and the future workforce, that is for our graduate and postgraduate students. With this, I would like to invite Dean Academics, Dr. Rohit Singh, sir, to introduce all of you to the university. Please, sir.
Thank you, Indrani. Thank you so much. My pleasure and privilege to welcome honorable guest, Mr. Sunil Parekh, sir, who was here with us on 24th of July 2014 as a guest for my second convocation. So, sir, welcome you again for this conference as one of the guests for us. Thank you so much for accepting our request and being here. Mr. Rajesh from IIT Gandhinagar, Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, Professor Rajan Velukar, the registrar, Mr. Ajay Kumar Yadav, the head School of Business, Dr. Monica Suri, coordinator Indrani Sen Gupta, my other faculty coordinator, Roni Bhatt, and other faculty members who are present over here. Thank you so much for joining. Sir, we thought of having this discussion with the people who are into the education institution, basically looking for the training, placement, and internship opportunity for the students. And we thought during this time, there are a lot of challenges and pressures which the institutes are facing in order to place the students into the market in front of the industry and the other professional organizations. And what we find it out that though there is a there is a match between the expectation of the industry and the provision from the university point of view. But there are some challenges which the institutions are facing, and they have delayed the recruitment process, they have delayed the selection process, and they suggested that let's wait for the pandemic to get over before we go on for recruitment and hiring process again. So we internally discussed and we thought, why not to bring the placement training officers on the panel and find it out what are the issues which they are facing and what probable challenges they will be overcoming once they decide on the strategy post COVID-19. And we thought, let's discuss and find out ways and means, because I think this pandemic will take its time till December before actually the next batch comes into picture and we'll look forward for the training and placement opportunities. So we thought, fine enough, we will have this discussion. But for the audience to know, this Aura University, as sir is also aware about, when sir came for the second convocation, sir, we had total of around 140, 100 to 160 students who were graduating. This year, they are supposed to graduate around 288. At that point of time, we were having only four schools, a school of business, a school of hospitality, IT and law. In 2017, we added a school of design. In 18, we added up a school of journalism and mass communication, and school of liberal arts and human sciences. Under the guidance of Professor Rajan Belukar, sir, this year we are going to start with the School of Sciences. And we have also opened few centers which are working in coordination with the industry and the society. We have one center taking care for the prenatal education, Oro Nojivan Sanskar Shikshan Kendra. And then we have Oro Psychological Counseling and Wellbeing, where we are providing counseling and sessions for the students, parents and people at large in the community. We also are trying to establish Center for Family Managed Business. And looking forward to establish Center for Rural Studies and few other centers and Center for Indic Studies in the Department of Liberal Arts and Human Sciences. Today, sir, we have total of around 1245 students. We are looking forward to add another 500 into this semester, 500 to 750. So the bench strength will increase to around 1600 plus students. We have now 75 faculty members into all these programs. And plus, we are having a lot of activities which are focusing on the overall development of the students and the faculty members. And as you all are aware, Aura University is based on the teaching and philosophy of Sri Aurobindo and the mother, where we are looking forward for the integral and transformational learning for the students. And we cover four aspects of education, basically physical, mental, vital and spiritual. And we try to imbibe this into our teaching and learning pedagogy, where we emphasize upon 20, 30, 50 principle. And we often say 20% of learning in the student happen when they listen to it, 30% of the learning happen when they see to it, and maximum learning happens when you engage student into the process of teaching learning, that is 50% by doing. And happy to share that this is what we were doing from 2011, and recently into the new national education policy also they have emphasized you should focus not what is but how you are going to do it. So they have also emphasized on learning by doing. So, and we have near about now a total of 28 programs, UG and PG, along with the PhD program in all the schools, sizable international collaborations where we are giving opportunities for the students and faculty to interact, do research, bring that practical learning into the classroom teaching learning process. So, though we are a little bit, you can say in terms of number, very conscious that we are not going after too many numbers, but we are focusing upon the quality. And I hope my faculty members and other colleagues will be supporting us like in the past to take us to the realistic objective which we have set out in the mission, vision and the mission of the university. So thank you so much, sir. Pleasure having you again and look forward to listening to you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Rohit, sir. I would now like to invite Head School of Business, Dr. Monica Suri, ma'am, to set the theme of the conference by introducing it. Please, ma'am.
Thank you, Indrani. And once again, warm welcome to all the participants and dignitaries who have joined us on this very first day of our conference, 2 days conference. As the theme of the conference is already been aligned to placement, which is actually the changing and challenging role of placement officers across country, specifically in India, across B schools. So as you know that the buzzword across the B schools today, or maybe in the past also, or in the future as well, will be placements. because every institution thinks from the student-centric approach. And I personally feel as an academician that when there's a right to education, there's a right to placement. Because as per the accountability lie on us as School of Business and also higher education institutions, I think the prime concern in front of us in the time of COVID-19 is how to enhance the employability scope of our students in the upcoming time, specifically for next 2 years when everything is going to be very uncertain. And I'm sure the infrastructure has already been taken care of, whether it is with respect to the digital learning and specifically with respect to the virtual internships that we are offering to our students. And now, without compromising on the quality aspects, because there's no physical contact of the students, specifically when they are going for virtual trainings and internships. And obviously not to deteriorate the impact of this internship also, which will actually give them good hands-on practical exposure to a real-time scenario, is a big challenge. But I'm sure many of us who have joined this particular conference, academicians, specifically the academic fraternity, I think they have already done proactive plannings that how to actually take care of this aspect of placement and how to revamp and rethink and restructure the framework of placement, which will actually complement this COVID-19 situation as per the expectation of the industries, as per the expectation of the students who are joining. And I'm actually, giving assurance to all the parents also, because they are the most important stakeholder. And being a parent, I know what is the importance of education and what is the importance of employability when I'm spending so much on my child's education, specifically with respect to post-graduation, and then they are going to join the industry with good packages. So I understand, I completely, truly, emotionally, psychologically understand the concern of every parent. So I feel that we institutions are working in line to what is expected out of us. And the new education policy, we had recently a webinar on new education policy, and it was very useful for us as academicians, because we came to know that how they have accommodated the virtual internship and also the integration of industry and academia, which we are talking since last so many years that there's a gap. And we have filled the gap also with experiential learning. Like at Oro, we have incubation cell in place, wherein, we have active participation of industry, and we have advisory boards on place, wherein industry is also, aligned to the teaching curriculum, and they are designing and they are guiding us what are the new aspects of teaching learning which we need to actually include in various specializations. So though we are doing it, but I think that this is a time to come up with a uniform framework. And I feel that education industry is one industry which never works on competition. There's an approach called co-optation, that is cooperation and competition, which is required at this point in time, wherein we all Indian and global universities and industries need to come forward. We need to collaborate. We need to restructure and rethink the whole process of internship and placement from a new perspective, so that everybody should get benefit out of it. And no student should be left without any placement. So if they are willing for joining the industry, there should be scope for them. Their grooming, their other technical aspects should be taken care of by us. And I'm sure all these deliberations we are going to do in the whole conference, because we have many technical sessions lined up, and we have exclusively designed each technical session from the perspective of various career opportunities for the students in the area of marketing, human resource, operations, supply chain, which is the most important aspect right now, and also the core and USP of Oro University, that is entrepreneurship and family business management. So all these aspects we are going to cover in the extended specialized talks and the technical sessions. And the beauty of all the sessions is it's a good blend of academicians and industry experts. So you'll not find any technical session or talk wherein you will not find a good combination of academicians deliberating upon various important aspects in collaboration with the industry experts. So I'm actually keen to come up with this particular great learning experience for next 2 days. And I'm sure we as Oro University, we are already proactively working on redesigning and revamping our placement activities also with respect to the profiling of our students, with respect to just understanding and identifying the needs from the new market and the new normal. So I'm sure we all will reach to some kind of common framework through these deliberations. And we are always open for collaborations in future as well. And I feel and I hope that with the eminent speakers in all the sessions, we'll get a roadmap for next 2 years, that how we need to actually rethink and restructure, whether it is the incubator cell of Oro University or the CDC of Oro, or maybe for any business school across the university, across the country, across globe. So with this, I'm actually looking forward for a great learning experience, and I've already kept my notepad ready to just give ourselves the deadlines and the targets for next 2 years, so that we can actually start proactively the grooming of students from technical and most importantly behavioral perspective, because Oro University believes in behavioral transformation as well. And we have seen that in this pandemic only those companies are sustaining who are behaviorally very strong in terms of their attitude, in terms of their welfare activities and well-being with respect to all the stakeholders. So I wish you all very good luck, and I thank my team, core committee team, for making this conference happen with lot of deliberations from experts and eminent speakers. And I equally thank all the participants for joining us for this conference. And I hope and I wish that they'll have a great time in next 2 days span of time. So wish you all very good luck. Thank you, Indrani. It's over to you. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for your for setting the context of the 2 day national conference. It is my privilege to welcome our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Dr. Rajan Veluka, sir, for his inaugural address. Sir, over to you.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you very much for giving me an opportunity to be the panelist with a very learned person, Mr. Sunil Parekh. In fact, I am not going to give a long speech, but I am also here like the participant to listen to him, as I am not from the management and I am not experienced in this placement services and other thing. But whatever thoughts I feel I should, I will try and put it in a short duration of time. Will not take much time, as I am also eager to listen to Mr. Sunil Parekh. Why this conference came into my mind, I tell you. Since last 3 months, I am looking for a person who will be appointed in the university in which I am working, the Oro University. And to my surprise, if I just tell you, just a second. I think the, yeah. So, to my surprise, I could not find a person who really is understanding the resilient world. What is going to happen in future and how do we address the issues? And therefore, a thought, I met several people, those who wanted a job or those who wanted to upgrade themselves. Joined some university as a placement officer or something. And I must tell you that I did not get a person who really understand the resilient world. What kind of resilient mind we will need? And how do we prepare these young people for the future? How do we inculcate a habit of knowing the purpose of their life? And therefore I thought that why can't we meet several people, those who are in this field, and understand from them that what is happening and how we are going to address this issue. And therefore I asked Monica, who is the head of the School of Business, that why can't we organize a conference where industry and academia, both the practitioners and the academicians, will come together and then have a chat on this, have a dialogue on this, and understand what we exactly needs to be done. The changes are rapid. I love one sentence which I am using in my speeches since long, maybe more than 20 years. And I say, change is mandatory. Survival is optional. Now, which is more true today, if you want to survive, then you need to understand how fast action and how corrections you will have to make always. It is not that you are thinking for 10 years. No, gone are the days. Every 6 months, you will have to make the corrections. and you will have to adjust yourself. You will have to align with whatever changes which are happening. And the whole thing, whatever we need to think, is from this perspective. That is what, as an outsider, I would say, outsider in terms of the discipline, what we are talking. And therefore, now what they say is we need super minds, not substitutes. Substitute is not going to help you. So we will need the super minds. And in this present world, we will have to think designing human-machine collaborations. Unless and until we design machine and human collaborations, we will not be able to understand the future of work, and we will not be able to push the better future of work and understand that. See, with this AI, artificial intelligence and machine learning, now every person should know what it is. You may not be expert in that, but at least you are aware of the artificial intelligence and machine learning, where IBM is thinking of how to bring compassion. Now they are remembering Gandhi. How do we bring compassion and love into the machine learning, into the artificial intelligence, so that we take care of the sustainable human beings? And that is where the people are thinking. And that is where the all placement officers will have to cross the boundaries which they were doing till today. They will have to cross the boundaries. It is not only providing the job, but they will have to go beyond. I in a lighter vein, I say, a person who cannot employ himself or herself, nobody is going to give you a job. If you cannot employ yourself, nobody is going to give you a job. And therefore, we need to create a mindset of that young person, including me, to prepare them. We just go back to 100 years. 100 years before, what has happened? The electricity has transformed almost everything in our life 100 years before. Now, what is happening is, this in today's world, this artificial intelligence is changing. Everything will change in coming years. We don't know what kind of new technologies which are going to come. If we say after 10 years, it comes in 2 years only. We are not able to predict that also. And therefore, actually, we have a very, very hard time that industry will think without AI. Whichever industry, whether NGO, non-profit organization, also will have to think of AI. The universities also will have to use artificial intelligence in understanding the data of these young people, whether it is quantitative or qualitative, including behavior. Because every moment we are behaving in a certain fashion. Understand that trend. The moment you understand that trend using artificial intelligence, actually the Oro University used little bit of artificial intelligence in conducting of examination. The online examination which we have. Am I audible? I think Monica?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Good.
Okay. Yeah, yeah. You are audible. I just came closer because I thought it was an important point.
No, sir. So we used the artificial intelligence in online examination, and we are trying to use it for creating a portfolio of learning of students, e-portfolio. And all that what we are talking, what the world is talking, the league, Ivy League universities, we are trying to bring it to our university. Infrastructure is excellent. The teachers are very, very sincere. But then we are also thinking of all those things. One more point which the research says, what it says in this field is people are looking to achieve very big numbers. Scalability is very, very important in today's world. More than 700 billion population. And everybody will have to think from 700 billion population. whatever we do, whichever field we are in. So the people are thinking about big numbers. Earlier, they had incremental 5 to 10% goals in reducing their workforce. Now, I used to say that before 2008, the situation was complicated. After 2008 of recession, the situation became complex. And post-COVID, it has become complexly complex. And if it is complexly complex, earlier what we were thinking? Reducing a workforce by 5 to 10%. But now it is reverse. Now they are saying, why can't we do it with 1% of the people we have? See what kind of numbers which they are thinking. And if the whole industry and the whole world is thinking from this point of view, then post-COVID, the placement officer's role will be more dynamic. They will have to be more vibrant. And they will have to come out with the schemes which they can. Finally, though I am here to listen more than talking, there are 5 points which we should understand, which I have just jotted down in the morning. One is, people will want to work with organization that has a purpose. Now, purpose is taking a center place in everybody's life. If you are not able to find the purpose in your life, you will not achieve anything in your life. So the purpose is important, and therefore the placement cell and the placement officer need to inculcate how to find the purpose in your life, because that is going to last for a long time. You may get a job, may be removed, as I have said, 1% only, whether the industry. But the purpose, that is what in the Oro University we are trying to inculcate. And therefore we are talking about integral education. We are trying to create a balance which was not there earlier, because we only focused on the physical world and not on the psychological world. At Oro University, through integral education, of course, your discipline at the highest excellence, we are trying to deliver to these young students or learners. But at the same time, we are also thinking about their entire life, and therefore that integral education we have integrated into our university. So the first is the purpose. Second, the people will expect lifelong growth and development. Growth in terms of the income and other things, lifestyle. Development in terms of developing the consciousness, understanding the society. Because in vertical literacy, we think of society and self. Society is important and self is also important. And then only the coexistence and co-creation, which operating system 4.0 is talking about. Co-creation, collaboration. Else we will not survive. The third point which people are thinking of, they say we will have to help manage the always on culture. That is called as always on culture caused by technology. Technology is changing every day. I have read that when the pager came, when we used to send messages, my son-in-law is in the business of this image creation. So his father started SMS service in 2020 through pagers. 20 years have been completed. In Stanford University, one of the professors taught a course in 2003 using pager. Now today we have so many tools, so much technology, and still we are suffering. Earlier, other people had apprehension, but later when the course was successful through pager, everybody agreed, and then many people came forward to deliver a course. If you have passion, you can learn. If you have passion, you can learn. The fourth is hybrid leaders. Hybrid leaders will be on demand. Hybrid means those who are thinking about private, public, and not-for-profit organization. All the three, the vision and mission of all the three needs to be aligned together if we really want to develop ourselves. I am not saying progress. Progress and development are two different words, having different meanings. I am concentrating on development. And the last is, the concept of job will not exist. Remember this. As I have said, if you can't employ yourself, nobody will employ. And therefore, the placement cell and the placement officers and the universities will have to change their mindset. You are changing your handset every 2 years, but you have to change the mindset also. Mindset is also very, very important. You may change your handset, but you will have to change mindset, and then only we will be able to. So think very differently, very, very differently, then only we will be able to. And the industry also will have to come one step down, because both industry and institutions are sitting at two different ends. They're not coming together, really. Academician says, no, theoretically you will have to teach. Industry says, no, theory you forget. We want these skills, you teach these skills. No, both will have to come together, like Buddha said, middle path, not extreme ends. Come to the middle path and we will. Let us be vibrant. From Oro University, I welcome all the participants in this conference, and I compliment the School of Management for organizing this. And this is the apt time for organizing this kind of events. But I am going to sit as a learner rather than, but as a Vice Chancellor, you have to speak. And therefore, I took little time. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Rajan sir. Thank you for setting up the context and also telling us that it is the time for all of us to think wisely and act also wisely. It is indeed my privilege to introduce amongst all of you today's special guests. So we have Mr. Sunil Parekh sir, co-chairman FICCI, strategic advisor, Cadila Healthcare Limited, Zydus Group, Ahmedabad. Sunil Parekh sir has studied BTech and MTech from IIT Delhi. He is currently advisor for Zydus Cadila Group and is also the chief corporate affairs. He is advisor for World Economic Forum since the year 2012. He was also a strategic advisor for Jubilant Group. Sunil Parekh sir is a patron member for TIE, we call TIE. He is also associated with FICCI as a Gujarat Council member since April 2007 and as a council member for the duration 2008 to 2011. Sunil Parekh sir is a board member at CIIE, IIMA since 2006 and founder of Pan IIT Gujarat Alumni. Sir, we welcome you on behalf of Oro University. We would like to hear from you, sir.
Thank you so much. So, Professor Rajan Velukar, I'm going to call you Dada now.
No.
We have given very good words of wisdom and you have laid a bigger roadmap than, to draw attention to the fact that we live in a society that is not only changing, that was a cliche, but the fact that it is changing much faster than otherwise has also become a reality. And I think this wake-up call that has been given by COVID has actually needs to be translated in meaningful ways, not only by the placement officer, but also by the people who are developing content and the pedagogy in the university. And you are absolutely right. It's a time to reflect. It's a time to change. And I think it's very important. I also want to thank Dr. Rohit Singh, who jogged my memory about the time that I had come as your guest for the second convocation. And I still vividly remember that it was a very good experience. I trust that now you have your own auditorium and you have your own facility, and you don't have to go to a hotel to be able to do such kind of programs. And it clearly marks, a development. I also want to say hello to doctors. Is it Dr. Suri, who is the head of business school, and Dr. Indrani Sengupta, who are also part of the organizing committee, and all the respected faculty. I have always felt that people who teach are it's a very noble profession. And I always have a lot of deep respect for this people who teach and the profession itself, because they actually are creating in their own way the blueprint of the new society. And they are the ones who translate the reality into practice. And therefore, they play such an important role in our society. And somewhere from the Vedic ages to now, somehow this entire position of respect and honor has not been the same as it was earlier. And I think when we are recreating this in a knowledge economy, I think the emergence of university that take their job seriously will probably be restored back to the same level as it was. Serious teachers, serious faculty, those who do their own independent thinking are the ones who are really going to make a difference. And I entirely agree with Dr. Velukar that size is not an issue. Yes, you need to scale. But if you produce leaders in a university, then they take care of the scaling up by bringing their own personal knowledge to the place of work. I also want to say thank you to Pankaj Tibak. I see he's on the line also. I know he's busy with his other program of having to attend the program with the Prime Minister of India today, when he's going to launch some award for honest taxpayers at 11 o'clock. I was also supposed to go there, but I had already taken a commitment with you, so I have excused myself from there. So friends, very briefly, what I want to do with you is, let me give you an outline of what I'm going to speak. And as FICCI, I assume that, the purpose of calling me was that I would now like to give you, offer a window to the situation on the ground in industry and the changing world that we are experiencing every day in industry. And how do we in industry look at the changing scenario? And therefore, this would have direct relevance in terms of what placements and what curriculum is required as we go forward in this making these changes. Let me begin with the first few lines on the fact that we are genuinely living in unprecedented times in our lifetime. I've seen the movie, and I would urge all of you to see the Spanish flu movie to see how different it was then and now. And it really brings home the fact that how much has changed in 100 years is something that is really worth watching. We have experienced loss of lives and livelihoods. All our fault lines have been absolutely exposed, whether it is the economic inequality that we have seen coming out in the form of the problems of the migrants and the workers, or whether it is the fault lines in the public health system. Also, in a very short time, it is as if we have had a complete reset. Now we have virtual learning, we have work from home, we have online shopping. And the home has become a theater, it has become a school, it has become a university, it has become an office. And suddenly we find that, in a matter of 3 to 4 months, the entire role of the house and the entire role of our activities has shifted dramatically. The digitization that has happened in the last 2 months, people say that it normally would have taken anything between 2 to 5 years to happen otherwise. So it's been a great acceleration in this respect. And the figures that people quote in the world to prove this point is that Zoom, the audio-video conference company, had 10 million customers before COVID, and now they have crossed 200 million paid customers in the world. Now, this by no stretch of imagination would have been conceivable or feasible except for the pressure that it has created. Even in the area of e-commerce, what has happened in the last 3 months has exceeded what has happened in the last, would I expect it to happen in 10 years. And similarly in teleconsulting, in telemedicine, and so on and so forth, in very many areas. The world has lost 400 million jobs, and 100 million poor people now are pushed into extreme poverty from just being poor. And these are matters of great concern, and these are not small changes that have happened just by the sheer size of the problem. The GDP so far, what we have lost and anticipation of loss, is about $9 trillion, which is 10% of the world's GDP would be lost. And this figure of loss is roughly, to get a sense of magnitude, it is 3 times the annual GDP of India itself. And we know that for a fact that, we are now officially in a depressed economic area. 1.6 billion children are out of schools and colleges, and this is not a small thing that has happened. And in business today, people are not asking about return on the capital invested, but they are asking about return of capital itself. And this has been quite a shock. The NPAs in the banks, which are now reduced from about 10.5% to about 7%, and in terms of actual numbers is about 8 lakh crores, are expected to increase by another 5 lakh crores till the time of September. So this is going to put a severe pressure on the banking system and will have its own repercussions in terms of placement, development, growth and capital requirement. Roughly we expect, as has been the experience in the past, that about 20% of MSMEs don't survive these kind of big shocks. And that means in India, we have 6.3 crore SMEs, and 20% of that would be about 1.25 crore SMEs are likely to remain completely shut even after the situation improves. Now, this is the big scenario that has actually happened on the ground. And sometimes we miss the big picture because we see small shoots happening here and there. But this is a big black swan event. Some people call it the white swan event because people had warned about it and we have done nothing about it. And this is true of not only India, but also of the world. Let me go on to the next point about what has happened to industry during this period. So I'll break up the industries into two major categories. One is the essential industry and one is the non-essential industry. The essential industries are those which have been allowed to run during this period and they have done reasonably well. And they are quite a few. For example, all the utilities, whether it is water, electricity, gas, or internet, they've all worked well. In fact, internet has been the backbone which has allowed us to pass through this very difficult period without problems. The agro and food industry, the transport industry, the pharmaceutical industry, the healthcare industry, the fertilizer industry, the pesticide industry, the logistics, the storage have all done reasonably well. Banking has also done reasonably well because it continued throughout this period. Education has done well primarily because it was able to pivot from the offline to the online model. But there are stresses and pressures economically, like we also have for non-COVID hospitals and overall in the healthcare sector as well. Telecom has done well. Entertainment has done well. Information technology has done exceptionally well. Sale of hardware devices, including laptops and other things, have done exceptionally well. And in the number of startups and the areas of health tech have increased significantly. And today, all hands are on deck to develop new vaccines, new medicines, and personal protective equipment, and a host of other areas for R&D that have emerged. So these are the sectors that have actually done reasonably well, and they will continue to give employment even during this difficult period, barring aside a hiccup of maybe 6 to 9 months. The non-essential industry, which is a very large part of the economy, and in order to get our GDP going, it is the non-essential part of the industry that actually contributes a very significant portion. So while the essential industries have been running, we have seen that our GDP has actually shrunk. And you know, this is clearly an indication that this sector is not enough to sustain the larger industry, which is outside of what we regard as not immediately required for survival. These non-essential industries, which have done exceptionally badly and are not likely to recover, and I have a timetable chart, but I won't bother to put it up, as to which sector is likely to take how much time to recover. But the following sectors have done very badly. Malls, retail and shops are the ones that have been the worst hit, and the entire retail industry is a very significant part of the economy because everything that everybody buys goes through some kind of a retail outlet. The second big area that has been badly affected is hotel, restaurants and travel industry. And this is also, I heard you saying that you want to have a center of excellence in this, and you must actually develop an innovative model by thinking independently of how to revive this essential part of requirement of people in a manner that is consistent with the current times for safety and social distancing. The third area is recreation and outdoor parks and indoor parks. Fourth is events. And you know, the event industry has become very large in India, irrespective of the type of large events we do. The construction industry has also come to a grinding halt. And this is a very big sector involving about 250 sectors which are dependent on the construction industry for their jobs to supply for both for housing as well as for industrial applications. Normally, we say that, you know, based on our experience of the two mishaps that we have had in 1997-98, 20 years ago, we had the ASEAN crisis. And that was an ASEAN crisis, it was not a global crisis. In 10 years exactly later, in 2007-08, we had the global financial crisis. Again, it was a financial crisis and not a health crisis. And now, 10 years later, it is almost as if every 10 years, someone wants to punish mankind for whatever they have done wrong in 10 years. This is the COVID, and this is again a global event. And this time, it is a health and an economic crisis. And the health situation has still not come in control anywhere in the world. The Russian vaccine that has been shown has not released the data. So, you know, the Russian vaccine is not and is still going to be produced in commercial quantities. So I think, and you know, India will not probably feature as closely as it has its own requirement and its own close friends requirement. So the health situation is still definitely not come under control. Under the following situation, pundits of economic development who have studied past pandemics and past major crises have this to offer us, that if we find a vaccine by between September to December, which is actually available to the world, but the vaccination itself will take 6 months to 9 months, then in that case, the overall situation for recovery in industry is going to take about 9 months after that, which means we are talking about the next Diwali period. If the vaccine is available by March to June next year, which is like the likely scenario given the fact that vaccines traditionally have taken over 10 years to develop and we have now compressed it to something like 1.5 years using model techniques, tools and technology like the platform technologies. It would mean that, you know, this would mean that it will be probably closer to June of 2022. And when I say that June of 2022 or September of 2021, it means that whatever GDP shrinkage that we have had, we are now going to be back to that level. It does not mean that there is a buoyancy in growth. Normally, whatever happens after a major event like this is that both demand and supply both get completely crushed. First, the supply goes out of control because of lockdowns and because of fear. And once supply starts improving, they are facing a problem that there is no demand in the economy. People tend to save much more because they are afraid they will lose their jobs, the future is unclear, and nobody buys any kinds of goods, whether it is the non-essential type or others that which are not required for a day-to-day basis. And therefore, the demand for the non-essential sector actually shrinks to abysmal numbers. And therefore, under these circumstances, even after the pandemic becomes okay, people will still watch 3 to 6 months after that before they start making purchases. This is the experience of human psychology every time. And we have seen this play out in India also. So therefore, the pundits say that the demand creation in the economy will not happen before the last quarter of next year in the most optimistic scenario. So that is the view that I would like to share with you in terms of what is happening on the ground today. And please, friends, remember that even pre-COVID, the previous 11 quarters, the GDP has been consistently reducing quarter on quarter basis, year on year basis for almost 2.5 years before the COVID hit us. So this is the broad scenario in which an educational institution is placed when it is looking for placement and jobs. I would also now turn to the third point that I want to make, is that in every huge challenge, there are always opportunities. It's a cliche that we all use very frequently, but the fact is that it is a reality. And one only has to read the literature of how through every big economic challenge, new companies are born that have created world history, new products have emerged, new business models have emerged, and you know, they have created in many forms a solution to the crisis that has happened. And these are the companies that actually go on to become the leaders of tomorrow. All these five top Google, Alphabet, and Facebook, and many of these companies actually have seen their meteoric growth take place during these difficult times. There is also a non-tech side of the company that has also grown very big during the time of crisis. And therefore, this actually is a major opportunity to look at how do we convert, and you should have a program that says, how do we convert a challenge into an opportunity what are the tools and techniques, and there are tools and techniques to assess the problems and then come out with innovative solutions, and these are the ones that are likely to take us out of the problem that we are experiencing today. So I'm not at all gloomy or pessimistic with this situation, because forward-looking and innovative universities and students and industry always do very well even through very difficult times. I also want to now take to the next point, to the fourth sector, where I think there are 13 sectors which are really the silver lining on the cloud in these difficult times. And I want to enlist them for you because I know you have an eye for detail as you go forward. The first sector that is likely to do very well, in my opinion, is the defense sector. The total volume of production that has now been forced for indigenization, and there is a complete ban on imports, is roughly about $100 billion a year. And therefore, defense management, defense production, defense testing, defense deployment, and defense training are huge areas that have emerged in our economy, where there will be support from the government and a huge demand from the private sector to fulfill the requirement of import substitution. And this is not a gradual process. They have simply banned the imports of all these items. And therefore, this is going to happen very quickly. The second area that I think is going to be very important is pharmaceutical area. This is an area that we have seen there is a fault line in our system. We are not adequately covered to handle situations at a national level. Ayushman scheme has done a lot in terms of offering a family 5 lakh of rupees per year, a family of 5. But today the problem is that we don't have the necessary infrastructure and facilities. And therefore, this is healthcare and pharmaceutical management and development of new medicines, new drugs, and higher level of manufacture of medical is going to be one of the realities. I estimate this new opportunity at another $100 billion. The third is the import substitution for all the electronic items which are there. We import roughly $30 to $40 billion worth of electronic goods worldwide. And the government of India has now announced a scheme called PLI, which is a production-linked incentive scheme, which allows the local manufacturing of these items, including television and other things. Incidentally, television is banned now for importation. Now, can you imagine if 300 million people are going to buy televisions at approximately or roughly even at an average price of 15,000-20,000 rupees, the volume of this industry is available and it's in a huge way. The fourth, which is going to be the crowning success during this pandemic, is the IT services. And this includes things like the IoT, the Industry 4.0, the AR and VR, because I think a lot of people, for example, in our company and other companies, we are now using with less manpower, much more output productivity, and this is through AR, VR. A relatively new person goes into a factory, he wears the masks, the eyeglasses, and he is then remotely assisted by one single manager controlling 5 plants to do his day-to-day maintenance requirement instead of having separate maintenance teams in each of our factories. And there is simulation, there are so many areas where AR, VR has now actually entered factories and the results are outstanding. And therefore, this is a very big area. And the fifth area under this IT is the SaaS, the software as a service, PaaS, platform as a service. India created history by IT enabled services. Today, we have about 4.5 million people who are directly employed, and it generates about $170 billion in revenue, of which about $130 billion comes in foreign exchange. The next IT enabled services in India is SaaS. I would urge you all to read this detailed report that has come out by NASSCOM on SaaS to actually see the kind of potential that exists. And India is going to emerge, not because it wants to, but because the only country that has the ability to be the software as a service capital of the world. And I think this is an area that I definitely think that a university like yours should combine business management, technology, and look at this entire IT sector from the point of view of driving the future. I also agree with Rajanji tremendously in terms of the potential for AI, ML, and I would like to add the word blockchain. He has already elaborated on AI and ML, so I will not touch upon it, but blockchain is an area that is going to become very important. Mainly, it has been driven by one sector, and that is the retail sector. Anything that you want to export to Walmart in the U.S.,
in India today, this number is going to actually have a much bigger role to play in view of the fact that if formal jobs are not available, a lot of young people will then pick up this entire sector for their future development and growth. The 12th sector is in the area of risk management. All companies today require a very important risk management profile and system to make them resilient into the future. Models are available, but it will be a big area. And the last area that I think a large amount of business opportunity will develop will be in the area of business, is in the area of insurance. As problems increase, insurance increase, life as well as health. And therefore, to my mind, these 13 sectors actually represent the golden opportunity for a lot of people who can focus in areas that are likely to grow. I want to leave you with the last word that there are, how does a student or how does an individual or what kind of skills are required for a student to actually tap into these new opportunities that are coming through in this area and what are the changes that are required. And I think I want to revert back to the model that we developed in the World Economic Forum, which is about the 12 skill sets. But out of that, I really want to emphasize the four C's. And these four C's, and I'm sure every university has taken note of them, are about critical thinking, creativity, communication, and collaboration. And it is the ability of the university to actually think of how to apply this in a practical way and create the behavioral change so that a student then actually becomes a walking encyclopedia of combination of these four skills before he gets released into the society, then it will make a very big difference. And I want to share an alert with all of you, and I don't know how you have done it in your university, but this entire group of youngsters who are there in education today in the university are no more teenagers, but they are called screenagers. And these screenagers, we must drive home the point that while the phone is a boom, it can also be a curse. And it disrupts your ability to think, it disrupts your real relationship and meaningful engagement. And therefore, it is very important that, you know, they actually learn to handle this technology, a point that Dr. Rajan also mentioned about an always online culture. And truly, I would like to leave you with the last thoughts, and that is that it requires a different mindset. The mindset is not to be able to find the job, but to be able to contribute to a society yourself, where nothing is ready for you, but you actually help build and contribute to a new developing society. And that's the mindset that is going to make a difference as we go forward. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Sunil Parikh sir, for taking us through your insights. Now we move on to our next speaker for the inaugural, the keynote address to be given by Professor Abhay Raj Singh Gautam. Professor Dr. Abhay Raj Singh Gautam is the Head of Training and Placement and Career Development Cell at IIT Gandhinagar. He is a faculty in Material Science and Engineering Department of the Institute. Professor Gautam earned his doctorate from the University of Virginia. Before joining IIT, he was a postdoc fellow in the Lawrence Berkeley National Laboratory. Professor Gautam devised strategies and implements plan for the best job and entrepreneurial opportunities for IIT students. Please, sir, we would like to hear your words of wisdom.
Thank you, Ms. Imrani, for the introduction. First of all, I would like to thank the conference organizers for giving me the opportunity and a platform to speak and participate and listen to some wonderful words of wisdom that two speakers before me started with. And they have already set the stage very nicely. So Professor Rajan, he gave a very nice introduction in the beginning, setting up the big picture. And then just now, we heard Mr. Sunil Parikh, and then most of the things that I would like to cover, and in one way or another, they have touched upon it. But what I would like to share is that being part of the Career Development Services and specifically the Placement Office, I'll talk about what are the things that we look forward to, what are the challenges that we are looking at, and then what are the opportunities that we sense are coming along. Now, most of these are speculative at this point of time, because it's anybody's guess, because the industry is also calibrating their response to what's happening, versus academia, which is also going through a transformative change. So where we end up from here on, let's say 1 year or 2 years down the line, it's anybody's guess. But then at the same time, we have to know and we have to predict the direction so that we can take quick actions and then make sure that in the list of people who survive this entire process, we are at the top of the list. So to begin with, I would say, how is this current COVID situation different from all the past market ups and downs? So for instance, there all between talk about the financial crisis of 2008 and before that Asian crisis. And then one of the things that was unique about all the previous crises was either it was sectoral or it was regional, right? We never had a situation where everything got hit together. To give you an example, 2008, it was specifically financial crisis, which led into which was built upon the real estate. And because of the financial constraints, there were industries which suffered. But in long run, or even in the short run, it did not impact the fundamentals of economics in terms of the demand for the goods, and then therefore the manufacturing and so on and so forth, right? And then similarly, if we remember now, I guess the pre-COVID situation, that is in India, where we suddenly saw a sharp drop in manufacturing sector, performance of the manufacturing sector. Like Mr. Parekh mentioned, that we have continuously seen a shrinkage in the growth of GDP over the past 11 quarters. But just before the COVID hit us, actually the manufacturing saw a big drop. I mean, if you remember the automobile sector, there were companies which were reporting 30 to 50% drop in the demand. And then that manufacturing hit was massive. So to an extent that even in all the IITs, we saw a sharp drop in core area placements. However, in all these situations where we have seen some sort of a crisis, there's always been a way for us to balance out the act by moving or focusing our activities towards areas which have been performing well. So while the manufacturing was taking a hit in the Indian economy, the technology was doing extremely well. And then while the placements in core was suffering massively, at the same time, at IIT Gandhinagar, our placement statistics were running 20% ahead of last year, right? So we were doing extremely well, to the extent that we were at the all-time high for that particular month. And then those are very, those strategies have been built in the past. Older IITs have mastered it. The new ones are taking care of that as well. But what COVID did was that not only it impacted entire sector or entire industrial segment across, but it also covered the entire geographical region. So it's not that the demand in one region of the world was sort of balanced out by focusing on the other part of the world. And that opportunity was not available somehow. Well, and then because of that, we saw as soon as the lockdown and the shutdown started, the demand, our ability to bring in more opportunities for the students was very extremely small. There were still companies who were active, but they were just responding to what suddenly hit them. But then after that happened, the question was, how do we as placement services or career development services respond to such scenario? And then the answer is, we don't know clearly how it's going to evolve, but we do see some signs, and based on that we can predict, right, with best informed and take best informed decisions. And then to come to that, we are seeing changes both in industry and in academia. And then to give you an example, academia, just talking about IIT Gandhinagar, of course IITs and Indian education for a long time has been talking about expanding the massive online classes, democratizing the reach of education to general mass, and then in the process use the internet to its best capability. But those were things which were doing in bits and pieces. Academicians, when they had time, they would design courses and they'll run the massive online classes. IIT Gandhinagar was doing something along the same line. But as soon as the lockdown happened and we had to complete the semester, there was suddenly a huge amount of activity that we had to respond to because of the crisis. And then most of our classrooms started converting immediately into these online classroom stations, right? Where I can walk in and I can have 10 different technologies depending upon what my comfort level is, and then basically choose that and then deliver my lectures, involve the students, and then carry out all these, tremendously technology involved content delivery, which just a month before would have been a massive amount of work, which was always left out for, yes, when we have time, we will try to improve in that direction. And that was just immediate response. Immediately after that, and that was when we decided that the rest of the semester would be completed on pass-fail basis, because the students do not have the infrastructure to respond properly. We didn't have the right set of a design for the curriculum or academic activities, and therefore it would be unwise for us to actually go ahead and start grading the students on because both the faculty and the students were in that situation. Now we are going in next semester, we have already started the next semester where it's a graded course. And then again, the system is evolving. And that's just IIT Gandhinagar. If we look across the world, how the academic institutions are responding to all these, recently, Coursera kind of websites have started the complete degree program online. And then the reason is this online delivery platforms are becoming more and more efficient. At the same time, academicians are also becoming very efficient in delivering, designing courses, and at the end of the day, being able to compete in some cases, at least in some course segments, with the courses which are run in the classrooms. And if this model continues and the academic institutions keep on evolving, we can clearly see that in a near future, we are going to compete with universities which may not even be present physically in the Indian ecosystem. And then that access or choice to the student also brings in the point, how is the career development services going to add to the physical infrastructure of a university or institution which are operating in India and compete with some of the global best, right? And then the answer to that may not be very clear. I cannot definitely give you that answer at this point of time. But there are certain areas where, I guess, in the beginning, in the introduction, when Monica Suri mentioned that there's a competition and collaboration, that's never been more true than right now, right? And then to give you an example, when we started the online classes, when we are finally calibrating and understanding the opportunities, one of the initiative IIT Gandhinagar took was, while our faculty is delivering online classes, why is it not possible for us to bring in faculty which is geographically not located in IIT Gandhinagar, but are some of the world leaders in Indian education, and ask them to offer classes for IIT Gandhinagar to IIT Gandhinagar students? And then currently we are running roughly 20 or so courses where the faculty is not in India at all. Right? They are spread over Europe and then US. And then we are using all our connection to bring those. And then in some sense, that has created an opportunity which our students otherwise would not have access to. Because before we were trying hard to bring those faculty physically to IIT Gandhinagar to deliver the lectures. But now that is very easy. The faculty is available because they don't have the travel commitment and they don't have to leave the comfort of their country or home institute. At the same time, the students are benefiting from their experience. And then that allows us to bring the world-class education by collaborating. At the same time, we cannot completely rely on this model because then it's very easy for the foreign universities to take over the Indian education, higher education system. And then there we have to bring in value from various services, and career development happens to be one of those services. And then how do we bring about that? And one of that is initiative that was even started before this COVID crisis hit. And that is integrating some way the career development services in providing the feedback loop to the academics so that the academics can actually better design courses, come up with programs, which is more market relevant. And then in the process, in some ways, shortcut the entire process of academic innovation to be more market relevant. Right. If you start from the very beginning of the education institute, the luxury that education institute enjoyed in the past was that we had full luxury of deciding what would be the future direction of research, what would the future direction in which the student should be trained in. And then somehow the industry had to accommodate that skill set from the students who graduated. Most of the successful institutes now were somewhere in the middle. They do prioritize the future research, which looks forward 10, 20, 30 years ahead of time, which may not be exactly industry relevant at this point. But at the same time, they also focus a lot on providing the skill sets on top of that, which makes your students immediately employable, right? And then the balancing of those two acts can only be possible if we listen to the market. And at the same time, we also listen to academicians so that we don't end up in either of the extreme situations. And then that's where some of the institutes, at least some of the IITs, have already started integrating their academic design program and then bringing in the career development services into it so that they can have the feedback loop, which can be used immediately rather than starting a course, running it, and then going to the industry and asking them for the feedback at that point. Right. So I mean, there are a lot of opportunities in this case, and some of them are immediate and some of them are going to be the long-term one. Right. So if we look at the scenario right now, yes, the COVID has impacted our ability to reach out to the industry, but we are already seeing the sectors which have started to recover and are providing opportunities. Maybe not every company in that sector may be performing well, but if I name a few, pharma, finance, FMCG, services, but most importantly, technology. I mean, if you have followed up the news recently, there have been massive investment commitments, at least, in the technology sector. Google committing roughly $10 billion in the next 5 years or so. Jio is doing a massive investment in infrastructure expansion. And then all these things have, again, created a pent-up demand for high-skilled labor in the technology sector, right? And then, of course, Mr. Vice Chancellor already mentioned about that our need to understand the technology, be it artificial intelligence, machine learning, at least functional level, we need to understand what they do and how we can actually improve our ability to deliver our jobs while keeping these segments in mind. We can clearly see those things are making changes. Now, immediately speaking, I think the industry is gearing up, and then we can already see some of the recovery in the sense of physically the industry may not be able to come to IIT Gandhinagar, but we can clearly see that they have already planned out how they are going to carry out their recruitment process. And in the specific sectors that I mentioned, they are already looking at increasing some of the hiring processes, at least at the entry level of the high-skilled labor force. So I don't see a massive difference in terms of how the market is going to offer the jobs. Of course, the shift is going to be the type of job that was offered before versus the combination that is going to be offered now. And then that's where the placement services or the career development services have to keep their eyes open and run back to the institute, give the feedback there so that the institutes can equip their students so that they are job ready or they are appealing to the industry, the ones that are actually looking to hire. Of course, again, we do not see an immediate opening up in the manufacturing sector, the traditional manufacturing, for instance. But again, I mean, this manufacturing had been suffering even before the COVID came in. The idea was sometime in 2022, 2021, we will see the recovery happen. Again, that sector will come back with the jobs. And it will, again, I mean, the good in companies in that sector will survive, which will innovate through the process. What we in academia have to make sure that by the time that happens, our students are ready to join the workforce of those industries. So the point being that there's a continuous change that is happening. Of course, that was also mentioned earlier. But the pace at which that change is happening was also increasing over the period of time. What COVID has done, that it has finally accelerated a lot of those changes, be it online classrooms that were being prepared, where people are thinking about 10, 15 years down the line, we'll say that becoming a reality. But now it's here. I mean, whether we like it or not, it's happening, and then we have to respond to it. And we can respond by being more creative in using it as a tool to provide more value to our students, or we can sit back and see how it plays out, and in the process be left out, right? And then again, at the end, I would like to just say that there are plenty of opportunities, and then if we make the right choices, and then to a certain extent, if we are lucky in making those right choices, of course, we will be in a situation where companies like Zoom are right now. They bet on the right technology, and COVID just gave them the platform to massively grow. Similarly, the academic institutes can make those right choices, and placement service can play a big role in providing the information that's necessary to make those right choices. And in the short run, I think in a year or two, placement services will be back again where it is. The bigger question is that the change that's coming in the academic program or academic delivery platforms itself, are we going to be ready for that? And I think that would be one of the areas where I would look forward to listening. With that, I'll close, and I'll be around for any questions that might be there. Thank you. And thanks again for the organizers for having me.
Thank you so much, Dr. Abhay. Thank you so much for the wonderful inputs. So probably these things are also going to help us and our students for getting more ready and more prepped up. I can see a couple of questions here at the Q&A window. So, okay. So there's a question to Mr. Sunil. Sunil, sir, there's a question, and then we will come to Dr. Abhay. So in your opinion, what it is likely to be normal for students to be attending physical classes, or hybrid education will be the new normal for education? your views, and then probably we can take Dr. Abhay's views also.
Well, I'm on the board of about seven different academic institutions in the country, and I have come across a cross-section that generally says that it is going to be a hybrid model. The dependence on the online courses to the extent that it is there in COVID is definitely going to reduce as things become normal, but it is not going to go away. And I think that the range is anything between 20% to 70% in depending on the kinds of courses that are being taught. The online course platforms have become very powerful. A lot of learning is taking place on its own without actually doing formal teaching, or it is actually learning with some assisted teaching models. So, for example, the Delhi-based, both the Jindal School as well as the Hero Honda School have now opted for a plan for post-COVID in a manner that's going to require about 30% physical presence and 70% is going to be online. Whereas there are traditional universities in Gujarat and in the kind of courses you are teaching, the number of courses you are teaching, the number of teachers who are likely to stay with the teaching profession, and so on and so forth. But that's my feel, judging from what is happening on the ground today.
Thank you, Sunil. Now, if Dr. Abhay would like to say something.
So, I mean, what Mr. Sunil said, that's completely true. For instance, I can give you an example of the way things are evolving in IIT Gandhinagar. I mean, we are already scouting around on the websites, looking at some the reliable sources, and we are looking at the courses offered by some of the reputed institutes and all, and we are sort of building a list of courses, which we say that are approved by IIT Gandhinagar for our students to go ahead and take those courses and take credit for that, right, as they go forward. And then that has enriched the kind of courses that we can offer, which otherwise, if we relied completely on our faculty, would have not been possible, at least not immediately. So what this situation has allowed us to expand on the experience or the list of resource people who can offer courses on the area of expertise which we may not have on grounds. Right. And like I said, before our effort have been to bring those people short term, long term, or hire new people and bring those expertise to IIT Gandhinagar. But now we have this wonderful option that, I mean, as soon as the opportunity arrives, for instance, if tomorrow we learn that there's a massive scale up in hiring for students in let's say machine learning and artificial intelligence. I mean, I'm just giving an example. We do have a lot of faculty which are working in those areas, but if we have to scale up, we have a very good opportunity of reaching out to our partner institutes across the globe with which we have a memorandum of understandings, and we can ask them to commit a couple of faculty who can offer those courses, and then we can double it up by using our own faculty to bring that personal touch and then to the training program. So while we are looking forward to, if everything goes fine, having our students back on campus by next semester, but I cannot see going backwards and saying that everything that we did during the COVID cycle was just a temporary thing and it's going to go away. I just think that we are going to keep building upon these things. And then it's not something that which is going to be new, like IIT Gandhinagar is not going to take the initiative. MIT Open Courseware has been doing that for a while. It's just that the world is finally accepting that. And then also, our main consumer, which is the students, are also becoming more used to this medium of instruction. And as they become more efficient in absorbing the contents through these modes, it becomes much easier for academic institutes to go ahead and build more upon these platforms. So I look forward to a situation where we will be running both. I mean, physical presence is not going to be substituted completely, at least not in the near future, by the online classes. But the value addition by the online classes is also something that we should not be ignoring. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Abhay and Mr. Sunil. Now moving ahead, let me now invite the registrar, Sir Mr. Ajay Kumar Yadav, sir, to propose a formal vote of thanks for the inaugural. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Indrani. It's really a pleasure to listen to such wisdom and learned people in this inaugural session of the seminar. Certainly, this pandemic has brought certain problems for the people, but I see that it has brought a lot of opportunities for the people. In the sense that the online education or the online mode of learning, which was always considered to be not the best mode of learning, is now getting that acceptance. And with this dependency on technology and with the acceptance of the technology, the blended mode of education will bring educationists together, will bring institutions closer, and will provide better opportunities for learning to the learners. I thank you all. It's my sincere thanks to Mr. Sunil Parekh sir for coming again and sharing his wisdom with us and with the participants. Sir, thank you very much. Thanks to Professor Abhay Gautam for sharing his thoughts. Special thanks to our Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, Professor Rajan Velukar, sir, for sharing his thoughts on this national conference. And we hope that this conference will definitely discuss and deliberate upon issues which the student community is facing right now. Though I don't see it as a challenge, I see it as an opportunity where the institutions can think creatively, as Professor Abhay Gautam said, and work creatively for providing more opportunities to the students and prepare them for the days to come. Thank you all. Thank you very much.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Parekh and Mr. Gautam.
Thank you.
Madam, unmute your mic.
Yeah. Thank you, Parekh sir, for your precious presence. I know how occupied you are. And equally, thanks to Abhay sir. I know your session is already on, but still you spared your time. And my special thanks to Honorable VC sir for being here and being a great inspiration to all of us. Special thanks to Rohit sir and Yadav sir and to Indrani for being here and facilitating the session. So Indrani, I think if you have any announcement to make for the next session, you can go ahead. Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Abhay, and thank you, Mr. Sunil. Thank you, Velukar sir, and I look forward for more such interactions. Thank you once again on behalf of our university. Now for the participants, please stay here. We have wonderful special talks and technical sessions coming up just after the inaugural session. So we will be shorting in a very short stint. Thank you, everyone. Thank you once again.